Good morning, everybody. I hope you had a carb-free morning thus far. It is good to be here. For everybody that was here yesterday, you know that we could take this subject of health and wellness and make it fun. So I just want to welcome everybody who was not able to attend our first meeting. But let's just get to the point. What is the one thing that we talked about yesterday that really sums up everything when it comes to health and wellness? Well, first of all, everybody in this room probably wants or needs more energy throughout the day. A lot of us need to be more have more cognitive skills throughout the day. A lot of us need to be more alert, more engaged. And many times, we start to slip into what I call a carb coma. Let me get to the point. We are, as a society, as a westernized culture, we are over carbohydrated. We are eating too many carbs. Now, I'm not talking about vegetables. Vegetables are carbohydrates. What I'm referring to is the starchy carbs that's only been around in recent history. In other words, one of my take-homes is this. Ask yourself a question. Was it around 1,000 years ago? Whatever it is you're gonna eat. Now, I'm not talking about 1,000 years from now, like a Twinkie. I mean, was it, whatever you're gonna have, did they have the ability to eat that 1,000 years ago? Like, for example, does it grow in a tree or a bush? Have you ever seen a Cheeto bush? In my dreams, I have seen them, yes. But however, they're not real. So what we need to do is just simply ask the question, was it harvested, was it raised, or was it designed and developed in a laboratory? Was butter around 1,000 years ago? When I make my salmon, I make it in butter. You know why? I want to stay lean. I'm going to totally fly in the face of many things that the FDA, the USDA talks about. You know why? Because they're wrong. Let's go ahead and get started. See, a lot of people don't realize this, but I am formerly obese. I'm a fat guy. I was fat all my life. What happened was is I believed that I had bad genetics. I believed that my genetic encoding was flawed, and I was doomed to being not only the fat kid, but the fat guy. Turns out it wasn't that at all. I used to call myself a big boned person. I exercised since I was 13 years old. And the phrase is, you can't outrun a cheeseburger, you can't out-exercise a bad diet. And I had a very bad diet. See, I'm 100% Italian. That explains a lot. What's on my menu? Pasta, how you doing, huh? Hey. So I can speak Italian fluently. I used to eat bread, I was a breadaholic. Some of you heard this yesterday, but let me get to the point with a show of hands. How many people here believe knowledge is power? How many people here believe knowledge is power? I know most of the people here who were here yesterday did not raise their hand, and here's why. Knowledge in and of itself is not power, it's just information. And many of us are feeling guilty because we have the information and we know what to do. You see, what's the word that's missing? It's a verb. Applied. Applied knowledge is power. When we apply what we know, that's where we get results. Knowledge is information, but application is transformation. And when we start applying, out of everything that we talked about at yesterday's session, so many people came up to me afterwards and they said, you know what? You're right, it's the application of what I know, because most people know what to do. I'm not so presumptuous to believe that I'm going to bring to you all sorts of new concepts in health and wellness. Everything I talk about is very simple. It's just not easy. Why? Because can you see yourself doing it next year? See, as a former fat guy who was chronically overweight, when I stepped on the scale, 36% of that number was body fat. And then one day I began to realize, wait a minute, maybe it's not genetics. Maybe it's diet and lifestyle. 70 to 83% of all disease is diet and lifestyle related, which means it's controllable, which means we've got the power in our own hands to do something about it. It's called the knife, the fork, and the spoon. We've got the power in our own hands. It's just choosing differently. Most of results comes from nutrition. I used to focus all of my energies on exercise, as some of us do. And we even have a company in Atlanta called Bootcamp 360. It's really huge, got a lot of people coming. And what happens is we get a lot of people all the time, they say this. They say, I exercise so I could eat what I want. And I say, you don't have any idea how this works, do you? You see, it's not I exercise, eat what I want. When I exercise, I then began to realize I better start consuming fuels for my future. You see, yes, when I was in my 30s, I said, I better do something about it. So at 30 years old, I lost 20 pounds. I had my wife take a picture. Then at 40 years old, I had my wife take another picture. Then at 50 years old, I had another picture taken. And now I'm going on 65 years old. Eventually. You see, the truth is, I was born in 1964. When I was in my 30s, I felt old. I was tired. I was falling asleep in the middle of the day, trying to get work done. I felt like my head was in the cloud. My energy level was at an all-time low and getting lower every year. But then once I began to realize nutrition was the key, and I began to realize the power of carbohydrates, because that's all I used to consume, carbohydrates. Bread, pasta, more bread, potato, more bread. I would even order extra salad dressing on my salad. Why would I do that as a breadaholic? Many of you know exactly what I'm doing. Because at the end of the salad, you get a beautiful soupy mess that you sop up with your bread. Hope I'm not making anybody hungry. Three nutritional foundations. All right, now here's the way it's going to work. I'm going to ask you a question, but I want you to quietly fill in the answer. Number one, the first question is this. What is the first item we should look for when reading food labels? When you read a food label, what's the first item you look for? Now, I know a lot of guys will say price. Apart from price, is there anything that might be more important to look for when reading food labels? Number two is this. How many grams of sugar will fill a teaspoon? In other words, if I took this white processed table sugar and I filled up this teaspoon, how many grams of sugar will fill the teaspoon? Is it 2,400 grams, 1,600 grams, 940 on down? Now, please be realistic. Don't think, what does Dean want me to write? What do you honestly believe it is? Write it down. Number three, how many grams of fat is in a full cup of sugar? How many grams of fat is in a full cup of sugar? All right, write that down. Here we go. Let's get started. Number one, what's the most important thing to look for when reading food labels? Can I get a couple people? Yes, sir. That's a great answer, too, by the way. So what he does is he just goes right there and eats right at the supermarket before they put the label on. Now, who would thank you? That was a good answer, though. What else did I hear? Yes. Okay, high fructose corn syrup. All the way in the back. What'd you say? Sugar, very good. If anybody was in here in the meeting yesterday, you know, you're probably writing down sugar. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Carbs. By the way, carbs is a category, and the subcategory of carbs is sugar and also fiber. So please, I know you're probably looking for sugar more so, but be aware of that. Anybody else? Portion size, excellent. Yes, sir. Sodium, because as we learned yesterday, sodium is very bad for you. Is that right? For those of you who were in our meeting yesterday, one of the take homes that I had in the meeting yesterday was, if and only if you eat real food without labels, if you eat food that is packaged, processed, canned, frozen, you need to be concerned with your sodium intake. However, if you eat real food prepared the way they did 1,000 years ago, put the salt shaker back on the table. However, two kinds of salt I recommend. Pink Himalayan salt and sea salt. Where do you get this exotic sodium? Costco, supermarkets. You could buy this everywhere. What's the most important thing to look for in reading food labels? How many people with a show of hands said sugar? Okay, it's a lot, but not as much as I thought it would be. Here's the way, the answer, and somebody did get it right. What's your name, sir? Roy? Floyd? Floyd got it right. And what did you say, nice and loud? Serving size is the number one most important thing. Now, why is that, though? First of all, everything that you mentioned, everything you wrote is important. However, everything you did write is based on serving size. Many times we think, I only had one serving. When I was growing up, I'm sure many of you in Italian household, you see what's called a family-styled serving platter. Did you ever see those? where you take something and you take something out of there and you pass it. Everybody in our house got one of those for themselves. I never realized there was something wrong with it till a friend from college came over to visit and we were eating. He got, and my mother, you know, placed down all these serving size platters and he said, aren't you gonna pass it? I said, why would I do that? You're gonna get one too. You came to the right place. You see, serving size is the most important thing to look for when reading food labels.